Going live, 3, 2, 1.
Everyone, as we begin our program, I request our beloved Thirumeni to lead us in prayer.
Let us bow our heads in a word of prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we have forgiven those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, our Lord is with you. Blessed art you among women, and blessed the fruit of your womb, our Lord Jesus Christ. O Virgin Saint Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and always, and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Thank you, Thirumeni. It is with great joy that I welcome you all to the first ever Dr. Paulos Mar Gregorius study series organized as part of the Study Wing initiative by NGOSM Delhi. I take this opportunity to welcome our beloved Thirumeni, His Grace Dr. Yohanon Mar Dimitrius, and our esteemed resource person, Reverend Father Dr. Bijesh Philip. I also extend a hearty welcome to all our diverse panelists, Reverend Father Cherian Joseph, Vice President of NGOSM Delhi, Professor A. Sabu John, Counseling Psychologist and Lecturer, Christ College, Ghaziabad Campus, Isaac V. Sampson, General Secretary of NGOSM Delhi, Ananya Elizabeth Vergis from Mar Gregorius Orthodox Church, Noida, Alina Sara Samuel from St. Mary's Cathedral, Hoskas, Shino Shaji K from St. Stephen's Orthodox Church, Dilshad Garden, and Janice Matthew from Mar Gregorius Orthodox Church, Noida. I, Feba Mariam Panikir, will be the moderator for the evening. I request our very own Thirumeni, His Grace Dr. Yohanon Mar Dimitrius, to present the inaugural address. Thirumeni, I'm sorry to interrupt, you're on mute.
Right. Reverend Father Cherian Joseph, Vice President of the Delhi Unit of the NGOCSM, valued resource person for this evening's program, Father Dr. Bijesh Philip, Feba Panikkar, moderator of this session of the program, very honorable members of the panel, and all my brothers and sisters who are viewing this program through Zoom. Good evening to all of you, and welcome to this inaugural program featuring the thoughts, the writings of our Metropolitan Dr. Paulos Mar Gregorius of blessed memory, the first Metropolitan of the Diocese of Delhi. God gave me an opportunity to meet this versatile genius and profound thinker and theologian. And when I speak about him this evening, it would be from my personal encounter with Metropolitan Mar Gregorius. As with all great thinkers, Metropolitan Dr. Paulos Mar Gregorius was a person who was appreciated very much outside our Malankara Orthodox Church, and whose rich and valuable abilities were not always recognized within the church. When I remember one occasion when I visited the St. Vladimir's Theological Seminary in New York. I was talking to one of the professors there, and he is saying that, Father, you know, I had a personal encounter with Metropolitan Gregorius. It was through just one Bible study session that I joined the Orthodox Church. That was how deep one single session of a Bible study with Metropolitan Gregorius had transformed the thinking of a former person who was belonged to another Christian denomination. Metropolitan Gregorius Thirumeni's ability lay in the fact that he could look at an issue on its fundamental level, whether it was Marxism or psychiatry, psychology, science and religion. He could analyze everything from a very fundamental perspective and come out with an analysis that would be shocking, that would be innovative, that would be beyond our ordinary reckoning. Let me just present a couple of instances. For one, many in the West are of the impression that the great thoughts of the Western world, especially the democratic communities, owe their origins to Greece and the legal system to Rome. And Metropolitan Gregorius on one occasion was speaking to a group of people, and he's saying that is not where the origins of Western societies are. It's not Greece. It is from India that the ideas were carried because of the commercial exchange that we had with the Roman Empire. And as we know today, more and more, we are seeing how research and investigation have thrown open the understanding of the richness of the commercial exchanges that India had with the Roman Empire. Approximately 200 to 500 ships traveled from the west coast of India to the port side in Alexandria, and from there it would be carried, the merchandise would be taken away. And along with merchandise, one must think that religious ideas, philosophical ideas, all this were transmitted to the larger context, social context, cultural context of the Middle East. And so therefore, these were the kind of innovative thinking that Metropolitan Gregorius was able to share with others who were open to his ideas. His theological understanding, and that's what probably we'll be dealing with most, was based on a personal reading of the writings of the church fathers, especially the Cappadocian fathers, St. Gregory of Nyssa, St. Gregory of Nazianzus, and St. Basil. All these, the writings of these fathers, formed, as it were, the basis of how Metropolitan Gregorius looked at the world and looked at human agencies. From that perspective, he could say that the essence of God was enduring love. And that love meant that God was not just focused on Christians or Christian churches or a larger Christian body, but would embrace all of humanity. He would always argue that the Holy Spirit just would not work with the church alone, but even with communism, socialism, because ultimately God was working towards the transformation of the entire world. And therefore, when he looked at theology, it was how God in his openness and his love for creation was guiding all creation towards its point of fulfillment. And therefore, when you deeply believe in God and you have the theological understanding and you are able to look at everything around you, Metropolitan Gregorius looked at the human being and he was saying, what is it that makes a person human? What is it that enables him to fulfill the image of God in him? And so therefore, for Metropolitan Gregorius, just in a simple understanding, is that whatever enslaves, whatever is keeping man fettered and reduces his God-given freedom, that is an impediment to his full growth. And so his writings, and especially the writings that he wrote against nuclear armaments and the development of nuclear weapons, calling for disarmament, for science and technology to work together for human development, the relationship between countries and communities, looking at the negative aspects of globalization and commercialization, and all these made him a person who was a versatile genius. I'm going to conclude this opening address here because Father Dr. Bijesh Philip will be speaking more detailed, but certainly my hope is that through this channel, through this point, this program, you viewers who have never seen or heard Metropolitan Gregorius Tirumeni will come to appreciate and have an abiding interest in this great treasure that the Malankara Orthodox Church gave to the world, Metropolitan Dr. Paulos Mar Gregorius of blessed memory. I want to thank Reverend Father Cherian Joseph for taking this initiative, the members of the MGOCSM Delhi unit for putting this program together. And I want to extend my deep thanks to Father Dr. Bijesh Philip for spending time this evening to carry forward the objectives of this program, and to all the panel members for making this exciting and wonderful program a reality and an experience for all our members, not just limited to the MGOCSM, but anybody who is interested in learning more about Metropolitan Dr. Paulos Mar Gregorius. May Almighty God bless all of you as you participate in this program. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tirumeni, for those words of encouragement. His Grace Dr. Paulos Mar Gregorius is one of our celebrated former metropolitans who has contributed significantly to the rich history of our church. He was a multifaceted individual with a list of countless achievements to his credit. A few of them include chairing the World Conference on Faith, Science and the Future in Cambridge, USA in 1979. He was also the General Secretary of the Orthodox Student Movement in the years 1955 to 57, and the President of the World Council of Churches and many more. Episode one of our series is focused on one of the articles written by Dr. PMG, A Sacramental Humanism, published in the Christian Century in the year 1970. Through this article, Tirumeni has penned down his thoughts as to how his mind has changed and the older ideas have been replaced with newer ones. He favors humanist principles like individual freedom, human dignity, and values. Augustinism, power of words, freedom, nature and destiny of man are just among a few of the themes that he highlights in his paper. Through this series, we aim to spread awareness about the teachings and ideologies of Dr. PMG. Our resource person for the evening is Reverend Father Dr. Bijesh Philip, the Associate Director of Sopana Orthodox. I would now like to invite Bijesh Sachin to take over and introduce and elucidate Dr. PMG's article, A Sacramental Humanism, to our panelists and viewers. Over to you, Acha.
Hello. Is it audible?
Yes, Acha.
Thank you. glory be to the triune God. Most respected Demetrios Thirumeni, respected Cherian Joseph Achan, respected Ms. Heba, the moderator of today's program, and all the panelists and all dear friends. At the outset, let me appreciate the initiative of MGOCSM Delhi Diocese to study your former metropolitan Paulos Mar Gregorio's profound thoughts. I am happy to let you know that I had the privilege to be a student of Mar Gregorio's. When I was studying at our seminary in Kottayam, Paulos Mar Gregorio's Thirumeni was the principal there. His Grace Demetrios Thirumeni has also taught me. I am still a student of Mar Gregorio's. So today, I am joining you all to learn from Mar Gregorio's thought world. Today, you have planned to have a discussion focusing on Mar Gregorio's article on sacramental humanism. So I consider it as a privilege to be part of this first Dr. Paulos Mar Gregorio's study under the auspices of MGOCSM Delhi Diocese. As you know, Paulos Mar Gregorio's was a great doctor who worked hard to heal the church and the world through a vision therapy. He shrewdly examined the modern world, diagnosed its ailments, and prescribed medicines for the restoration of its health. He wanted the church to be a healing presence in the world. Already, our beloved Demetrios Thirumeni has given a beautiful and enlightening introduction to his life and theological contributions. Before trying to analyze the specific article on sacramental humanism, let us have a look at a few important source materials with which he developed his profound and insightful thought world. Paulos Mar Gregorio's Thirumeni was undoubtedly a polymath, with his knowledge extending to numerous fields of knowledge. The basic sources of his theologizing can be listed as follows. 1, the Christian theology. He had deep knowledge in Bible, patristics, that is the wisdom of ancient Christian fathers, and modern Christian writers, church history and liturgy. His deep understanding of the scriptures is visible in most of his works, especially in his books, The Gospel of the Kingdom, Be Still and Know, and The Meaning of Diaconia. He has used the wisdom of the ancient Christian fathers very well in his theologizing, especially he has used the theology of Saint Gregory of Nyssa. His books like The Faith of Our Fathers, Cosmic Men, and Human Presence reveal his patristic understanding. 2nd source material, that is philosophy. His deep understanding of Eastern and Western philosophy is the reason for the depth of his profound insights. His book, The Quest for Certainty, and Philosophy East and West, are introduction to various philosophies. Then 3rd, other religions. His knowledge of almost all major religions is evident from many of his works. In addition to Christianity, he seems to be an expert, especially in Hinduism and Buddhism. 4th, secularism with its products like science and technology, education, market economy, and socialism or Marxism. His work on European Enlightenment movement, that is, the title is A Light Too Bright, is a good critical analysis of modernism. His works, Science for Sane Societies and Science and Our Future, articulate his proficiency in modern science and its philosophy. His book, Holistic Healing, reveals the drawbacks of the modern Western medical system, worldwide travel and ecumenical exposure. The sixth, exposure to various cultures through languages. In addition to a few Indian languages and English, he learned biblical, classical, and patristic Greek, Latin, Spanish, French, German, Italian, and Portuguese, biblical Hebrew, Syriac, and Amharic. Such exposure to languages opened the doors to various modern and ancient cultures. All these sources contributed to develop a sound anthropology and vision of global peace. But Mark Gregorius confesses that God is the ultimate source of everything good in him. In his own words, I want to acknowledge freely that whatever there has been some good in me and in my words and acts has come entirely from him, means God, for he is the source of all good and I recognize him as such. The topic of our discussion today is the 10th chapter of his beautiful autobiography, Love's Freedom, The Grand Mystery. This chapter with the title, A Sacramental Humanism, was first published in a magazine called Christian Century in 1970. This article gives a brief description about a few of his dear themes and how these thoughts evolved through a few years. This gives a comprehensive view of his thought world, and because of the brevity of the presentation, it is not easy to understand many of those things discussed in this article without referring to his other books and articles. So by confessing my inability to do justice to analyze the rich content of the article of this versatile genius and prolific writer in just 20 minutes, let me try to make an attempt towards this by your blessings and seeking the prayers of Mark Gregorius Theremene. Gregorius Theremene starts with a criticism of Augustinianism. Saint Augustine, who lived in 4th century, has influenced Western theology deeply, but Mark Gregorius is not ready to consider it as a standard by which to measure all other doctrines and theologies. Mark Gregorius exposes the low view of matter, low view of this world and human being in Augustine's thought. Gregorius Theremene also critiques Augustine's soteriology, that is salvation concept, and his failure to understand the sacramental principle as integral to the human condition and to the incarnation. He is not ready to subscribe to the Augustine's thought that sin is almost constitutive of human nature. He also opposes the attempts to depict God as an arbitrary dictator who demands a slavish obedience of humans. Gregorius Theremene affirms the basic goodness of creation and especially of human beings, whose ultimate source and ground is God. Augustine has influenced the Western theology enormously, and even the reformers, that is Luther, Calvin, Zwingli, in 16th century, have imbibed some of his viewpoints into the Reformed theology. For Augustine, human beings without grace from God can do no good at all. Mark Gregorius is trying to give an alternative theology to correct this pessimistic understanding of humans. He avoids both the overemphasis of human sinfulness in the Western Christianity and the over-glorification of man in secular philosophy. Mark Gregorius' theology seems to take a moderate path, which makes man neither a beast nor a god, but gives due emphasis to human potentiality and human duty to shape one's own life and that of the world meaningfully. As he rightly says, Saint Augustine's understanding of man as totally sinful, without any capacity for good in him, could be understood only as a pious confession of human frailty, but not as a matter of faith to be taken wholly seriously. Mark Gregorius cannot tolerate a theology which regards evil itself as central to human nature and the whole of humanity as a lump of sin, out of which no movement towards the good can come. With the support of Eastern patristics, Mark Gregorius attempts to emphasize the fact that sin is not a part of human nature, but death and corruption can be considered as illnesses of the fallen human nature. Mark Gregorius says in this article, salvation is more than deliverance from sin. It is making man like God, bringing him into the fullness of humanity. This observation is against the distorted understanding of salvation in Augustine's thought. Mark Gregorius suggests a sacramental humanism as a corrective measure. A sacrament indicates the unique union of grace and matter to be a sanctifying and transforming divine presence. Human beings have also the potential to be the presence of God in this world. That is the sacramental nature. Another important theme discussed in this article is freedom, which is also so close to his heart. By detecting humans' danger of overthrowing all kinds of authority, hoping for freedom, Mark Gregorius attempted a deeper analysis of the meaning of human freedom. The titles of his books, like The Joy of Freedom, The Freedom of Man, Freedom and Authority, Love's Freedom, A Grand Mystery, etc., refer to his special concern for freedom and dignity of humans. It seems that a proper understanding of his concept of freedom will disclose the beauty of the major portion of his theology, and especially his understanding of man. Freedom came to be recognized as a widely accepted watchword of modern scientific civilization. From the time of Renaissance onwards, people in the West struggled hard to free themselves from the extreme authority of the church, and also from the sovereign God as presented by the Western Church. In the post-Renaissance, a secularist phase of human civilization, the centrality of God was ruled out and an anthropocentric worldview was emphasized. What Mark Gregorius tried was to uphold the dignity and freedom of man by rejecting the vision of a freedom-hating sovereign God and highlighting a God who is basically love and freedom. Mark Gregorius develops his vision of freedom mainly based on the teaching of Saint Gregory of Nyssa, one of the Cappadocian fathers, who saw the freedom of man as the central element to which everything was to be related. Being created in the image of God, man should have all the good things in God, and among these, the most important is freedom. God is free. He is not bound by his creation. he is transcendent because of the difference of his essence from that of the creation. God is independent in other dimensions also. He chooses and do good without any external pressure. Since God is free, humans who are his images can also be free and independent. Modern colonization, decolonization struggles or independent struggles, emancipation movement, liberation struggles, etc., endorse this human thirst for freedom. Freedom from personal evil, from socio-economic oppressions, from parochialism, bold access into the presence of God and doing good, or shaping a world of justice and peace are expressions of human freedom. So to be free means to be free from crazy pleasure-seeking passions, false inhibitions, and also to be free from socio-economic and political oppressions and unjust structures. Positively, it is a capacity to conceive the good in new forms and then to create that good. He mentions this in this article. He also emphasizes the fact that individual freedom is inseparable from the freedom of the collective, that is, the capacity of the community to conceive, choose, and attain the good. Gregorius also criticizes the corporate egoism behind the modern missions of the Western churches. He goes to the extent of calling such missions a missionary colonialism and expressions of the cultural and economic aggressiveness of the West. He says that relief agencies and mission boards control the younger churches through the foreign finances, ideas, and person. This is a suffocation to the young churches. He also discusses the Orthodox understanding of theosis or deification as a supreme goal of human existence in this article. He says, I now firmly believe that the destiny of man is to be like God in every respect. He further explains that humans must become like God in love, wisdom, power, and holiness. Gregorius Thirumenes' understanding of theosis, that is becoming like God, is very significant to know his anthropology. He describes it as the key to the Asian African Christian tradition. In Western Christian tradition, the goal of mystical life seems to be the vision or knowledge of God, whereas this Eastern Orthodox tradition emphasizes the human participation in God and becoming like God. Being created in the image of God, man has the potentiality for this process of becoming like God. Quoting Gregory of Nyssa, Mar Gregorius describes it as an eternal progress. Being liberated from evil, humans can progress through spiritual discipline by participating in God. Personal cultivation and participation in the sacramental life of the church are facilitating this process of divinization or deification. So becoming like God means becoming like Christ, and this is the vocation of man on earth. Thus, man becomes a true image of God or presence of God. So in the ultimate analysis, theosis or deification means becoming fully human, which is the result of cooperation of God and man. In the context of postmodern scientific attempts of human augmentation and transhumanism, this Gregorian thought about human destiny is very, very significant. Worship or prayer is for the fulfillment of humans. His definition of prayer is noticeable in this regard. Prayer is communion or communication with God, opening ourselves to him and receiving his love. It is by living consciously in this relationship of love that we can be transformed into the image of God. By prayer, we become more like God, more loving, more wise, more powerful, more kind and good. So, God and become God. He explains it in many of his books, especially in his Worship in a Secular Age. Mar Gregorio's understanding of social justice is deeply connected to his view of the sacramental nature of humans and that of the church. Being a priest of the world, it is the duty of the church to bring divine blessings to this world. Mar Gregorio writes thus, "My notions of social justice come from my understanding of the communion of saints, and I can understand the ministry of the church in the world only in terms of a fresh understanding of the sacramental principle and the sacramental ministry." He writes this in his autobiography. Mar Gregorius thinks that vision of the kingdom of God is not identical with an urban technological paradise. We can come closer to a paradise on earth by overcoming dehumanizing alienations and conflicts. So his disalienation project, as he mentioned in this article, is a call to bridge the gap or chasm that separates urban technical man from God. A call to man to regain control of the economic, social, and political structures. A call to nations, groups, and individuals to learn again to develop trust and have compassion for each other. A call to man to find himself or herself not in a well of activity, but in the depths of silence. Thus, when we overcome conflicts and build up trust among nations and various communities, we can avoid wasting our resources and energy. The resources now wasted for building up arms reserves can thus be diverted to science, education, the elimination of poverty, and the enhancement of human creativity. The coronavirus and the present crisis seem to make this call more louder. Gregorios in this article says that it is not words or new theology, but God and a pattern of life, a type of personality, a way of living, being, doing, and thinking can solve our problems. It is a misunderstanding to think that communication is mainly through words. Our thoughts, actions, and gestures all communicate. So Mar Gregorios calls us for an authentic new way of living the Christian life in Indian context. This is a brief analysis of the insights in his article on sacramental humanism. So I wind up this presentation. Hope that there will be some time for reflections, questions, answers, queries. Thank you.
Yes, Achar. Thank you so much for illuminating the thoughts of Dr. PMG and his article in such a beautiful and compact way. We now move on to our panel discussion, and our panelists will now be putting up their questions. And I also urge the viewers to send in their questions via the comment box. So let's begin with our first panelist, Mr. Isaac P. Samson.
Okay, Priva. Good evening, Achar. So it was indeed a great session. So my question is centered around the fourth part of this article, that is understanding of freedom. So I'm just stating out two statements that is stated in the article. First one is freedom in the positive sense means creativity that is spontaneous, not caused by the external pressures. The second statement is to be free also means not to be directed by one's passion and ambitions. So my question is, Achar, creativity that is spontaneous, most of the times it's derived from the one's passion and one's ambitions only. So this concept of freedom seems to be a little self-contradictory. So what should be the exact definition of freedom, or what what Thirumeni is trying to understand and make us understand regarding the definition of freedom through this article.
Thank you, Aizu. Yes, Acha, over to you.
Yeah. Thank you. As already I have mentioned in my presentation, human freedom or the concept of freedom is a theme very close to Mar Gregorio's heart. He has written a lot about freedom in many of his books and articles. The ultimate standard for understanding human freedom, according to Gregorio Thirumeni, is God and God's own freedom. God is doing good without any external pressure or selfish interest. It is when we reflect, means humans imbibe and acquire this freedom, we will become truly God's images. Being created in his image, others like Saint Irenaeus, Saint Clement of Alexandria, and Cappadocian fathers have described the rationality of humans as freedom from the captivity of base instincts and dehumanizing passions. But animals are irrational, and they are not free from their bodily appetites and passions. So Mar Gregorio's quotes, Gregory of Nyssa, who teaches that most of the animals use their hands as pillars to support their body, whereas for humans, these are free by virtue of their erect or standing position. So they are free to use them to raise these towards heaven in prayer and also to help others. So Mar Gregorius uses, Thirumeni uses the terms passions and ambitions in a negative sense to indicate humans' crazy pleasure seeking and self-gratification. Disciplining and control of such passions, such dehumanizing passions, is inevitable for cultivating our inner self. However, this freedom from passions and personal evil is only a first step in our progress in freedom. Freedom from unjust structures, freedom from parochialism, freedom to enter into the presence of God, that is worship, and freedom to do good are other important steps in this ladder of freedom. Thank you, Isaac, for this very stimulating question. This is just a brief idea about Thirumeni's vision of freedom, which is very pivotal to all his theologies.
Thank you.
Thank you, Acha. Thank you, Isaac. We now have another one of our panelists, Ms. Ananya, who will be putting forth her question.
Good evening, Acha. In the second part of this article, Dr. Paulosna Gregorios Thirumeni says that communication can take place through our voice, through our ears, and even through our conscious mind. Also, our gestures and even the facial expressions, they also communicate. Also, Acha, in today's world, as we all know, that communication has taken various different forms, like WhatsApp voice calls, video calls, even through emojis and text messages, we all are able to communicate. So Acha, my question to you is that, how can we as students, or how can any person frame or mold his or her thoughts words and actions wisely. Because we all know that it is our own thoughts which later on take the form of actions and words. So how can we mold our thoughts wisely? Thank you, Acha.
Okay, thank you, Ananya. I think that answer to that question is hidden in your question itself. So whatever we communicate and express is coming from our inner thought world. So thoughts should be good. What Mar Grigorius Thirumeni tries to communicate is that rational interpretations of faith and our situations alone will not solve issues. So just by rational theologizing alone, we cannot solve the issues of this world. It is in this context that he says, communication is not only through words. Our thoughts, our gestures, our actions, and even our silence can communicate. So as followers of the Lord, we have to take seriously Jesus' teaching in Beatitudes, that blessed are the pure in heart. It is extremely important to keep our minds pure and clean. It is a universal truth that what we sow, we will reap. What we sow in our heart will grow there and will come out one day. So there should be an extra care regarding what we are depositing in our hearts. So we have to deposit only good things and divine wisdom in our minds. Also, Jesus taught us to abide in him, abide in Jesus, to bear good fruit. So growth in deification with our communion with him is very, very important. A good tree produces good fruits. Cosmetic changes or external rectifications alone will not help. A positive transformation in our being in communion with the triune God will be helpful. So then
I totally agree with you, Acha. I'm sorry to interrupt. But you're absolutely correct that in this fast-moving world, we are often undervaluing the values of behaviors and all. So I'll move on to the next panelist as we are short on time. I'll be asking our next panelist, Professor Sabu, to put up his question.
Acha, very good evening. And thank you so much for simplifying the amazing work of Paulus Mar Grigorius Thirumeni. I have one question from the later parts of this article of sacramental humanism. He talks about a fifth reason of why he changes his mind, and he speaks about the need and importance of mission and mission work. And he talks about the mission itself becoming a greatest enemy of ours, and he spoke about the possibility of missionary colonialism and the possibility of a cultural aggression. Now, my humble question to you, this is from even my personal understanding, I am trying to raise this question to you. Now, we as a church, the Orthodox Church, believes in that cultural and ethnic centrality of our liturgy, which is deeply rooted in the culture. So can our mission be possible without a cultural base in it and be as direct as just the gospel and word of God? How can we view this and move forward?
Yeah, it's a very significant question which needs more time for discussion and answering, but let me try my level best to put it in simple words. Thank you, Sabu. What Mar Grigorius criticizes in this article is the institutionalized mission of the Western Church. especially that of Catholic and Protestant churches. He noticed some of these as part of the colonial expansion trend of the West. New churches formed by these missions experienced such missions as cultural imperialism and neo-colonialism because of the control of foreign financing and personnel. The young churches in the two-third world felt a kind of suffocation. So what he opposes is the institutionalized mission of the West, which was insensitive to the culture and the dignity of the beneficiaries. For example, the American mission in Northeast states like Nagaland, as a result of that conversion, actually the tribals lost their cultural identity to a great extent. Now they are forced to follow many of the American cultural values and dressing and many other things. So that cultural uprooting is part of this foreign mission. This is just an example. That is why he is using that expression, cultural imperialism. But the Orthodox tradition gives importance to the identification with the beneficiaries, total identification. It is an incarnational approach. Completely being in sensitivity to the dignity and culture of those new areas and new communities where the missionaries come. See, for example, from a Russian Orthodox Church in modern period, saints like Saint Innocent and Saint Herman went to Alaska. And that Alaskan mission from the Russian Orthodox Church is a beautiful example of an Orthodox mission. And it is from there that mission spread all over America, and the Orthodox Church of America developed based on that.
Thank you so much, Acha and Professor Sabu, for that question. Rightly, culture cannot be segregated from the individual. It does need to be looked at when gospel is being preached to the masses, and Achin is very well put it forward. And we have Alina. Alina, do you want to put up your question, or do you want to try?
Yes, yes, I will do that. Yeah. Good evening, Acha. So my question is that in today's world where individualism is very cherished and emphasized upon, you know, it's all about my choice, my freedom. How can this idea, Thrimini's idea of collective freedom as the final outcome of, as the solution to emancipation of man, be conceived by today's generation?
Thank you, Alina. What Thrimini is trying to communicate is the interconnectedness of individual or personal freedom and freedom of the society or freedom of the community. The interconnectedness of individual freedom and that of the freedom of the masses or the society. Unity of mankind is always at the back of his thought, Mark Gregorio's theology. So he visualizes mankind as one body. So each individual can be seen as a single cell in that body. Freedom and health of both are contributing to each other. So let me use the analogy of COVID-19 situation to explain this. It will be very difficult for an individual to maintain his or her freedom from virus when everyone else is infected in his society. So it is essential to do the necessary to ensure vaccination of all to maintain the freedom of that society. And freedom of the community is inevitable for each individual's freedom. So individual freedom and the freedom of mankind or society or community, these two are mutually enriching and encouraging. This is what Thirumeni is teaching in this article. This is what I could feel.
Thank you, Alina. Thank you, Acha. I think freedom is our favorite topic for the day because we have one more question from one of our viewers and it's centered around freedom too. Like the question is from Mr. Jitin Sunny and he asks that, is freedom from the animal instincts our path to salvation? Is that what Mar Gregorius calls freedom?
See, that is just one aspect of freedom. Maybe the first step. How to discipline animals within us. For example, Saint Basil the Great in 4th century, while interpreting the Genesis account of creation, he says, the God-given power of human beings to rule the animals need not be understood literally. But it is the power to rule the animal passions and nature within us. Only by disciplining those appetites, we can cultivate our spiritual life, inner life. So the next step of freedom is liberation from socio-economic, political injustices and oppressions. Even that is also a step towards higher experience of freedom. That is entrance, that is another step, freedom from parochialism, communalism. Again, he describes other higher glorious steps of freedom. We have to enter into the presence of God because all other steps are just bringing human beings to the threshold of freedom. Only by having communion or only by worshiping God, we can enjoy true freedom. Then as a result of that, another glorious step of freedom, we can do good without any pressures, without any selfish interests. So only then we will be like Christ, completely free. So I think that this is just a bird's eye view of his broad understanding of freedom.
Thank you. Thank you, Acha. I hope for the viewers that answers the question. And one more question from the viewers before I move on to our panelists. I want to give time to our viewers. So the question is, how do we handle the present challenge of cyber human evolution and artificial intelligence in the light of sacramental humanism? I think it's a heavy question, but... Should I repeat, Acha, or is it okay?
I don't know whether I'll be able to answer that question, but let me just try. Transhumanism is an attempt to synthesize biology and technology. Biology, that means it is an attempt to enhance the human possibilities by connecting our brain and our organs to the electronics and technology. You know about humanoid robots and artificial intelligence is progressing beyond our imagination. But the sacramental humanism is drawing our attention to a real, authentic, genuine human progress towards perfection, not an artificial one. And in transhumanism, what will be happening is the reduction of the true authentic human nature. But this theosis concept or deification through our cooperation with divine grace and communion with God and by the help of the Holy Spirit, our human nature will be enhanced. We will be deified. We will be becoming like Christ. And that is also a very important step in human evolution. And that leads to real joy, real peace of life that gives fulfillment, real fulfillment to human life. But artificial intelligence, it will have many hidden purposes and agendas to build up or to make some superhuman beings, whether we will be able to develop more compassionate, more loving human beings with the help of technology, that I don't know. But this process of sacramental humanism is really helping us be fully human, to be like God. Then only we will be fulfilled. And time is given in history for this fulfillment. And we are in an embryonic stage. As this whole universe is under evolution and still under construction, our human life is also under construction. We need more grace, more help of the Holy Spirit for that fulfillment. Then we will be more loving, more compassionate, more concerned about the health of our environment and justice and peace of guides us.
Okay, thank you so much, Acha.
Thank you.
So thank Mr. Sanjay Rafael Burgess for putting up this very well-worded question. And now moving on to panelists, coming back to panelists, I would like Ms. Janice to put up her question now.
Good evening, Acha. Like in the article, in the first part of the article, Paulus Mar Gregorius Thirumeni criticizes saying that Augustine's soteriology went wrong. And he says that we are caught in a negative view and individual view of salvation. So my question to you is, what are these negative views of salvation and how such views can transform or change or affect our spiritual thought process?
Saint Augustine overemphasized the sinful nature of human beings. And it was Saint Augustine who developed this original sin concept. Even the sexual union of parents and the birth of a child are described as sinful activities. See, he took very seriously the description of King David in 51 Psalm, that I was conceived in my mother's womb in sin. Actually, that is a figurative way of saying that from childhood onwards, I am a grave sinner. But Augustine was developing a doctrine based on that figurative description. So sin is not integral part of human nature. This is what Mar Gregorius says. So that low understanding of human being that Mar Gregorius is not ready to appreciate and accept. Instead of that, he highlights human freedom, human dignity, and human potential. God-given grace See, being created in the image of God, man has that potential to grow, to be like God, to be free fully. Maybe because of the sinful activities, that possibility may be a little bit distorted. So the people belonging to other communities outside the borders of the church, when they do some good things, we have to appreciate. That is the expression of the image of God. So the negative view of the salvation in Augustine is that salvation means just liberation from this sin, personal evil. But Mar Gregorios is emphasizing the positive aspects of salvation and freedom. That is the fulfillment of human potential and becoming like God. Already we explained those things. So without understanding his vision of deification, we will not get an idea about the fullness of salvation.
Thank you, Janice. Now, coming to the last panelist for the day and the last question, we have Shino Shaji, who's going to put up the next question. Over to you, Shino.
A lot of questions. Okay.
Last question, Acha.
Okay.
Good evening, Acha.
Yeah.
Good evening, Acha.
Good evening.
So my question is that His Grace Paulus Mar Gregorios mentions to direct the resources into sciences, but is it audible now?
Yes.
Is it audible?
Okay. Yes.
So His Grace Paulus Mar Gregorios mentions to direct resources into sciences, but isn't science itself a threat to religion today?
No, not at all. He has beautifully described how science developed in Europe in modern period. And his emphasis is the complementarity of science and religion. So religion should join hands with the science to build up a more humane, just and peaceful society. Sometimes science is under the captivity of too much profit-making and violence and conflicts in this world. For example, many scientists are forced to use their energy and time for molding most sophisticated arms and weapons for annihilating the so-called outsiders and enemies. Likewise, because of the impact of consumerist culture, a lot of scientists are searching for more devices and instruments and objects for gratifying our selfish pleasure seeking. So religion with its insights may be helpful to science to be liberated from this kind of captivity. Likewise, science can help religions to be free from many superstitions. For example, there are many religious leaders who still think that around 6,000 years ago, God created Adam and Eve. And around 6,000 or 8,000 years ago, this world was created by God. But science is giving us a different picture. It is a long process. this universe is an evolving world. So how to give a more meaningful interpretation to the doctrine of creation with the help of science, that is also very important. So science and religion can complement, and they can join hands to really build up a new, better, humane, compassionate, just, peaceful world and society. This is what Gregorius Sirmeni teaches.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Acha. Thank you, Shino. And I think the excess of questions only shows that our children have read the article really well and have gone through it and prepared themselves. I would like to thank you, Acha, for being absolutely so patient and answering all our queries. And these ideologies of Dr. PMG, they're really unique and progressive. And we've understood through today's session that they are holding value even in today's times, and we youngsters can definitely apply them in our everyday lives. And we're extremely thankful to you for taking out time and gracing us with your presence for this session. And I'm also really thankful to all our panelists for having such an active discussion on this theme and making our first episode, I believe, a success. And I hope all the viewers who are watching the session found it equally enlightening and enriching. And I thank you all for watching. I now request our Vice President of MJSM Delhi Diocese, Reverend Father Cherian Joseph, to please give the vote of thanks and conclude the program.
Thank you, Feba, respected Vijay Sachin, and all dear members of the panel. I'm really happy that we, the MJSM Delhi Diocese, is doing this program. And the very first session of this study series has been inaugurated by our most respected Dimitrios Sirmeni, and the session was taken by my own guru, Reverend Father Vijesh Philip. As he was speaking about Dr. Paulus Magrigorius, I was thinking about, you know, my old days, you know, as a student when Achan was taking classes. The same spirit is still there, even though Achan is in Kerala and grown old.
growing old, but still.
yes. But I think, you know, if I quote Gregorius Sirmeni's, especially from his article, Sacramental Humanism, he says that structural values and national ethos can change a person's face. Also, that facial change is always a result of change in personality. I have seen this in many of our gurus, especially Vijay Sachin. I'm really happy that whatever he speaks, you know, as all the panelists would have by now understood, whatever he spoke was, you know, it didn't go over your head, but it went to your heart, and it will make your brains to, you know, it will give some sparks, and it will make you to think differently from tomorrow. So this initiative itself is in its beginning stage, just to understand what Gregorius Sirmeni wanted to say through his articles. And today it was a dream, but today it has come true, and we hope, we the MJSM Delhi Diocese hopes, that this will be taken forward, and this we will have every month. Thank you very much, respected Vijay Sachin, for elucidating us with his with Dr. Paulus Magrigorius' ideas in a very simple and in a nutshell. Thank you very much, Achan. Thank you, all the panelists. And I give my thanks to our most respected Dimitrios Sirmeni also. He has left because of some other urgent meetings. Thank you all. Thank you very much. And we'll see in the next episode. Over to Feba.
Thank you, Achan.
Thank you all for watching. And now we'll be just finishing our meeting. Acha, audio is... Thank you.